Okay, let's continue our discussions about classes. Last time we started finally talking about classes, which is integral to the object-oriented programming activities. This is the most basic mechanism in object-oriented programming classes. And although they are very important, the mechanism is very similar to structures. It is the same as structures. Many data members inside a class, but on top of that, we have the member functions in the class that works on this data. So we have a group of data members, okay, which of course can have different types, and some functions that can work on these data is defined within the class. And we will see, although it is structured very simple, idea is very simple, it can be used in a very different way in terms of programming technique, and we will see how we are doing this. Okay, so basically we have classes with functions and data. Okay, when we say that in C++ our main task is to write classes, not functions. Of course, we are going to write functions, but functions will be just the members of these classes. Okay, and we had a simple class, day of year class. Okay, it holds two numbers in it, month and day. Okay, just two integers. With these two integers, I have this function output. Okay, when I declare a new day of year object like this. I have two of them. Okay, I can access their month and their day data members like this. Like I am accessing the structure members, I can make any assignment I like, and I can make this call d1.output. Okay, when I make this call, this function will run. Note that this function doesn't take any parameters. If you like to think in terms of parameters, you might think that, okay, you are sending this structure as a parameter to this output function. If you like to think about sending parameters to functions, we are sending this d1 as a parameter to this output. Okay, inside this function output, when the function output tries to refer to this month, it just says month. Nothing else. It is like a global for it, or it's like a function parameter for it. Okay, so it doesn't look like it is taking any parameters, but the only way to call this function output is from an object. Okay, you need to have an object or variable of the class. Okay, we call them objects of the class. On this object, I need to call this function. This function cannot be called without any object. Okay, you need to have exactly one object to make this function call. So if there should be an object, then that means that object is the parameter for this function. If you like to think it that way, it is not mentioned that way, or it is not described this way. But as C programmers, if you like to think that where is the parameter for this function, but the parameter is here. It is this one. If you like it that way. So it is not a constant parameter, it is a non-const parameter, and we will talk about this later. Actually, I mean, the real mechanism is exactly what I am saying. When you make this function call, d1.output, okay, in secret, a reference to this d1 object will be passed to this global function, if you like to think it that way. Write this program, okay, produce the assembly code for this program and see what kind of parameters this function is having. Okay, you will see that it's going to have a parameter of this object type day of year. Okay, so as I said, inside D1 I can access those variables and I can print it out, I can change the values. So it behaves like a structure. So what is the use for this one? I mean, this is very similar to struct, so I was already doing this. So instead of having these functions inside the struct, maybe I could have done this as a global function, and that's fine too. So what is so useful about this class definition? Why is it integral to the object-oriented programming? We will talk about this in this lecture, also in the rest of the semester too. Okay. So when you declare an object of a new type, of a new class, okay, you just do this: day of year. I have a day of year object. Today I have another day of year object, birthday. So in C++ terminology or in object-oriented terminology, okay, classes are types. Like integer is a type, a is a integer variable, right? We used to say this is the type name, this is a variable name. In object-oriented programming, we call this a class and we call this the object. Okay. So what else? For example, we learned about strings, right? String. And if I say str, this is my class name. Okay, and this is my object. Okay, so generally we do this. Generally, if the type is a fundamental type, that is the type defined by C or C++, like integer, double characters, or boolean, we call them types. So we call them types, and we call the objects of those types as variables. So this is a variable, this is a type. But if we write them, or if somebody else writes them, we call these classes, and these are the objects of the class. Okay. So the distinction is very important. Don't confuse between classes, okay, and objects. Classes are kind of blueprints of objects. Classes define things, objects realize them. Okay. So if there could be a single class like day of year, but I can have many objects of this day of year. I can say day of year A. I made 100 day of year objects, but I have a single class. Okay. So these are the blueprints of, for example, this is a very classical example actually. Blueprints of buildings, binaların planı gibi yani. Blueprints of buildings. I have a single blueprint of a building, okay. But I can make many buildings, okay. I can build them, I can sell them, and people will live in them. But they share the same blueprint, okay. They have the same plan, okay. I do it once very carefully. But I do it in many different places, and I know them. Each of them will have doors, and each of them will have rooms and electrical system, water delivery system, etc. This example will return a lot, and we will talk about them a lot. So, in object-oriented programming, we concentrate on classes, not functions. Okay, again. We will write functions, but classes are more central in our thinking of the programming. Okay, inside my classes or inside my objects, I have data, and I have operations that work on that data. Okay, I have operations that work on data. Classes, when you declare a class, okay, when you define a class, this is a class definition. This class definition doesn't occupy any memory space when the program runs. Okay, this class definition doesn't occupy any memory space, but the objects of the class occupies some place. How many bytes does it have? It has 4 for this one and 4 for this one. Not anything for this one, because for each object I need to repeat these two. Okay, so another distinction between classes and objects. Objects have memory positions, memory spaces. During the runtime, classes, they don't have it. Okay, when you declare an object, the compiler reserves some space, either in the stack or the heap or wherever you are doing it. But for the classes, no. if I declare this class, okay, if I declare this class, if I don't make any objects of it, then that means that my executable code doesn't have any trace of this class, okay, doesn't have anything to do with this class because I didn't use it, okay. So let's continue. We already talked about this. Let me go to the program itself where we are using this class definition, and we will come back and talk about those details later. Okay, a simple program that uses our simple class definition. R includes namespace, and like we are defining a struct, we are defining a class. We say that class day of year. This is the name of the new type, name of the new class. Okay, publicly we'll talk about it shortly. I have two data members and I have a single function member. And this is called the interface of the class arrayUse. Why do we call it interface? Because the programmer needs to see this class definition to be able to use it. Okay, I mean, if I am the customer of this class, if I am using this class, if I am not the programmer but the customer, I am using this class. All I need to know is, okay, all I need to know is what is public inside this class: output, month, and day. Because when I make declarations. When I make declarations of this class, when I make objects of this class, I should know that which one of the data members or the function members I can use. So I know that there is an integer data member, and there is a function. I can make calls for them. So let's make some definitions then. Class declaration, day of year, today, and birthday. Okay. Enter today's date, enter month as a number. So I took this number from the keyboard and I put this. Let me try to draw this. I put this here so that I don't forget. I need to write something. Let me put this. Okay, this is my memory, and when I say today, this is my today object. Today object, and inside today I have a month position and I have a day position. Then somewhere else in my memory I have birthday, and I have a month position and day position. Okay, so at the end of line 14,
ne güzel buraya yapmışlar, bana doğru çeviriyorlar odan için ya.
Okay, I make two objects and these are their memory locations at the end of line 14. At the end of line 14, this is the picture that I'm seeing in the memory. Okay, line 17. After I execute line 17, the user is going to enter something. Let's say 10. Now I have 10 here. Then line 19, the user will enter something. Let's say 23, and I have that. Okay. Then I will go. Then okay. For today, I did it. For birthday, I will do the same thing, 22 and 24, 7 and 17. So at the end of line 24, this is the picture. It's very similar to struct, okay? Up to now, it is very similar to struct. Then this, okay, let me try to copy this. So, what am I gonna, can I paste it? How did I do it last time? How did I paste it? Control V. No. Okay, maybe I should do the back. One more. Okay. How do I copy this?
Control C, what?
Control C, maybe, yeah. And Control V. Okay. So when I come to line 25 and 26, okay, say that today dot output. Okay. So today is a function, but it's not a today is an object. Okay. Today is an object, and it's an object of this class. Okay. When it says that today dot, so it means that it is going to access one of the members of the this object, one of the members of this object, today object, but it is not going to access a data memory, it's going to access a function memory. Okay, it's called the output. So the function output will work, but it will work on this data. Okay, so this data month and day is available for this function at line 26. Okay, for the birthday again, the syntax is very similar, but this function now will work on this data. Okay, so these two functions, they look like they are not taking any parameters, but in fact they know on what kind of data they are working on. This one is working on this month and day, this one is working on this month and day. So as the name implies, what they do is they just print out the details of the objects on the screen. Then I will have a simple comparison between these two objects. I say that if today's month is the birthday month, and if today's day is the birthday day, that means that these two objects are equal in terms of their values. They are equal, okay? In terms of their values, they are equal. Then I will say that happy birthday, because today is your birthday. Otherwise, today is not your birthday. Okay, that's it. That's what we do in this simple program. It uses the basic building block of the object-oriented programming technique classes, but we didn't do anything useful yet. Okay, we will talk about the useful stuff now. We are talking about the mechanism only. We will start talking about why we are doing this, why this is so important. First, we will teach you the syntax, then the mechanism, how we achieve this, and we will talk about the philosophy itself, the idea, main idea itself. Let's look at the output function. Output function, once it works, okay, when you think about the functions, member functions of classes, you always think that, okay, this one is working on some kind of an object, either today or birthday, okay, because there are two objects in our hand. There could have been many, many more. Okay, this output works on, let's say this one, 26. This one works on this today object output. It says that switch month is like a month, is like a parameter for this one, or the global. No, it's not global, it's not parameter, but month comes from this object because inside that object there are two data members, month and day. Okay, and there is the output function too. So this function can do three things with this object. It can access month, okay, it can access day, also it can call the other function output, okay. So it is okay if I do this output, okay. I can call output here, like this. So what would this do during runtime? This would go into an infinite recursion, right? We don't like this, but it is possible, because as I said, this one has access to all the members of this object. This object has three members. One of them is an integer month, one of them is integer day, the other one is a void function output. Okay, that function happens to be the same function as the calling one, but we know that it is possible to see. So switch month if mounted one, then see outset, then see outset, that this and this. And I did it, I did this for all the 12 months. Then if there is something wrong, if somebody enters minus 20 or 75 for the month, I say that, okay, there is an error. And finally, I print the day like that. And that's it. If I run this function, if I run this program, enter today's date 10/15, month February 21st. Okay, today's date is October 15. Your birthday is February 21st, and it says happy unbirthday because these two objects are not equal. That's what I did. Okay. So let's have some questions. Yes.
So in terms of functions inside Scrum, you have access to any variable.
Yes. Uh-huh.
When you say they have access, can they manipulate them? Can they like change?
Sure. Yeah. I mean, when I say access, they can. By access, I mean it is not just for reading. It is for modification. They can do. They are just variables, right? I mean, I can do whatever I want. I have inside this main function, I have access to this day integer, right? By access, I mean I can modify it like this, or I can print it out, or I can, without changing its value, I can take the value out and inspect it. Yes. Okay, another question? So, in object-oriented programming, we usually, on our data, we don't manipulate our data outside of the class. For example, this is not a good thing. This is not a good thing. This is not a good thing because we like to keep our data to ourselves by hiding it, okay? If the customer of this class, whoever is using this class, we are the customers of class string, okay? You have been customers of this type integer A, okay? You have been using this integer, okay? For the last 6 months of your young engineering career, okay? So you have been the customer of this integer class. You have been using it. So all you know is that this can store some integers like this. I can do operations like this. And you know that I can also do this, okay? So this is what you know. As the customer, this is what you know. You don't care about how you represent this integer in the memory. In fact, you even didn't know if the integer has 4 bytes or 8 bytes. You don't care. It is the responsibility of the compiler to declare that kind of size. If I need to know it, I would ask this question, what is the size of integer? It's the size of pointer. It would give you this. So, as a customer of this day of year class, all I need to know is what is available for me. So available is all the public things. Output is available, month is available, and day is available. So you can use them. You can modify month, you can modify day of object, or you can call output on them. Okay, these are available. But usually we don't like these data members to be available outside of the class. We like to hide them. Okay, why we like to hide them? We will talk about it in a few moments. Okay, so let's try to eliminate this kind of notation. Okay, I don't like this usage. I don't want to modify this month and day outside of class. So I will write another function here. I will write void input. Okay. So what do you think the input will do?
Take the value of the parameter.
Yeah. It will take the values of day and month from the keyboard, and it will store it in the whatever object it is working on. So instead of writing these lines, okay, I will just simply write today Okay, you compete with today dot input. Okay, as simple as this. Semicolon. Okay, again, here birthday dot input. Okay, that's it. So instead of repeating these five lines two times, I think it is copy paste and replace. I just say today dot input and today dot birthday dot input. As simple as this. So the as a customer, my job is very easy. It's like I am using this class. It is very well written and tested. I know that there is no problem. If there is a problem, it is a problem of the designer of the software, designer of this class. So as a customer, I just use those services. Like I am using, I never question if I have two string S1 and S2. Okay, when I say S1 plus get the concatenation S2, I never question, okay, how does this work? Are you sure? How does it work? And I just use it, right? I just use it. So in this case, I just say that today.input, I just use it. Today.input, birthday.input, I just use it. So input, maybe we can implement it later. Let's go on and here it is very good. It says that today.output, okay, birthday.output, it is already the way that we want it. How about this part? Again, these today.month, birthday.month, and today day and birthday day, they should be equal so that if those four things are equal, okay, this one is equal to this one and this one, then I would say that these two objects have equal values, but I don't want this excess. So maybe I should make into a function too. What kind of function it would be? Okay, let's talk about it. But before that, I think there is a question. Was there a question? No. So I will write this function. I mean, I will write such a function that this kind of data member access will be eliminated. I don't want to say today dot month because I want to hide it. So let's, as a customer, let's write the prototype. Let me erase this one so this is more. Another function, I am adding another function. That function name will be equal. Okay, and it will return a boolean. If two day of year objects are equal, it will return true, otherwise it will return false. Okay, so let's think about it. When I say okay today no today dot input today dot input, I know that input will work on that today object, but equal needs to access another object, right? Let's use it first. Let's use it first, and we will come here. So I like to say, first of all, maybe I should say, instead of this line, instead of this large line, maybe I should say today birthday. When I say this, it looks very logical. It looks very, very nice. It's an equals operation. Operator works and it returns a true if it is equal. But I didn't define this operator yet. This operator doesn't know how to compare to day of year objects. Okay, so I can't use it. If you write it this way, okay, you will get a compiler error. Compiler will say that this operator is not defined on day of year objects. Like this one. If I have two strings, if I have two strings like this one, S1 and S2, if you say S1 and S2, if you say this, S1 and S2, the compiler will tell you that nobody told me how to make this operation on those two strings. I know how to make an AND on Boolean operators, Boolean parameters, but I don't know how to do it with strings. So it is not implemented, it is not there, and we that's why we don't use it. So it is very similar to this one. Okay, this looks very nice. It is logical. It is easy to read, but nobody has implemented it. So I am not going to. I can't use it. So I am not going to use this operator yet. Later in the semester, when we do the operator overloading, we will know how to overload that equals operator to make that line work. So I'm going to say I should somehow compare today, okay, today dot equals, okay, I have a function named equals. If I say today dot equals and call it this way, the function equals will work on today object. It have access to two data members only, month and day, right? So it doesn't know how to compare it itself with somebody else. So I need to send that information. I need to send that information like birthday. Birthday. Okay. So if this one returns, if this function returns true, then that means that today and birthday are equal. If it returns false, then that means that they are not equal. Okay. So if statement works this way. This way, as the customer in my main function, as the customer, as you see, I am not accessing any data members of this class. Okay. So let's write this equals. Okay. It might look a little bit weird, a little bit complicated, but this is not. We have been doing this all the time. We have been doing this all the time. You were sending, okay, objects or structs to some functions. Okay. We said that you can send struct to functions. You can return them from the functions. That's why we did this many times. And we are doing something, this almost the same thing. We are sending an object to a function, but that function happens to be the member function of the day of year class. Okay? It doesn't matter. So since I am sending this object to the function, let's go back to the function definition. This one will need this function will need another day of year object. So day of year, and what name should I give this day of year? Other is a very good parameter name for this day of. Let me switch to blue. Let me switch to blue. Blue. Okay. Day of year. Other is a very good name for this parameter. Why? Well, let's talk about it when we implement this function. Okay, I will give you two implementations. One for the input, which is very simple, very similar to output. The other one is equal. Okay. Or maybe this name is better, right? Equal. Okay. When I call it, I will. I already read it. Write it that way. Okay, equal. When I read it, it is much better. Today equals birthday. Like I am. Asking a question. In some languages, they pose it as a question. Today is equal. Okay, the name of the function is a question. Actually, is equal, but we don't do it that way in C++. Okay, let's implement this one first, then implement the next one next. Any questions before implementation? Any questions? Let me have at least one question. Okay, you ask your question, but I will not count your question as a one question. Because you are, okay. Yes?
It says will, the goal of implementing those functions is to move month and day out of public, right?
Yeah, but we don't want our customers to modify or to read our data directly. Okay, if they are going to modify it or if they are going to read it, they should do it through our functions. Okay? The way I want them to be, the way I want them to modify to access. All the access should belong to mine, okay? They should not do any things, any operations on my data. If they like to do something, then they should call my function. That's the idea.
How do you move them out?
What do you mean?
Move them from public.
Well, I didn't talk about it yet. So first, I am saying that how do I achieve this situation? I mean, how do I remove any access, any reading or writing or modification of these data members in the main function? That's what I'm doing now. Yes.
Is there going to be any global function in object-oriented programming?
Unfortunately, well, I mean, this is a global function and you cannot eliminate it. Unfortunately, it is there. Okay. So there should be at least one or exactly one global function which is main. We usually don't like global functions in object-oriented programming, but in C++, since it tends to be compatible with the C programming language, yes, we have global functions in C++. But other pure object-oriented programming languages such as Java, they don't have global functions or global methods. Okay. Did everybody sign this? Okay, so let's start implementing this input. Where should I write input? Okay, I will write input here. Okay, when we talk about this output, implementation of the output, nobody asked about this, but I guess I showed this to you last time. Output is not a global function. It's a function defined inside of this class day of year. This is called scope resolution operator, binary scope resolution operator. Scope resolution operator. Okay, binary scope resolution operator, and it is written this way. If you say, I am defining a function named void output. Okay, this is a global function. This one needs parameters, or it will work on global data, right? So this is not a global function. I am defining a specific function that belongs to this class. Okay, so we will do the same thing with the input function. Okay, void day of year input. Okay, and inside this, okay, maybe some print statements, cout statements, cn month, okay, and cn day. That's it. Well, I omitted those print statements. Enter the day of the month and the day of the year, or the enter the month of the year. I omitted those statements. By the way, I think, yeah, enter today's date. Well, yeah, you see the problem right here. It says enter today's date, enter your birthday, right? Yeah, maybe I can keep them in the mean. Or maybe I have another solution. Maybe we will talk about it, but you see this. Maybe these two, 1, 2, 3, 4, maybe these four lines are, they should belong to the input function. Like they kept today's day. So this cout is inside the main, but output is defined inside the day of year. So maybe, as our friend suggested, maybe I should keep, I know how to do it. Good enough. A little bit more. Okay. Okay, I am amazed. When I do this kind of stuff, notifications, everybody gets so quiet and everybody. so excited, waiting for something to happen. And if I am not successful, if I do some mistake, then you will laugh. And human nature for some reason. I should use that technique for teaching better. I don't know how to do it. Okay, so this is our function input. Let's define this the other function output. I am not returning anything, it's void. Let's define the other function equals, and I will write equals here, and I will erase this one. Okay. Let's put it in here and make it smaller maybe. Okay. Okay, you start. What do I write? I am implementing this function equals. How do I start? What do I write here? It should return something. It's a function, right? Boolean. Okay. Then we will say day of year. Binary scope resolution operator equals, and it should take a parameter. Okay, it will take another day of year object, day of year object, and its name was other. Okay, at the end it will return a boolean. Okay, what is our algorithm? Our algorithm is same as this one. It is exactly. It should be exactly the same as this one. Let's write exactly the same thing. Or maybe without, I mean, maybe we should, maybe let's write it more explicitly. Okay. Let me define two booleans. Day equal and boolean month equal. I'm trying to divide it into partitions. Day equal is assigned the value of, okay, if the day values of my object, remember this is called this way, today dot equals birthday. Let's not forget about this. Let me write it here. It is called this way, today dot equal birthday. It was called this way. Okay. So if the day data members of today and birthday are the same, this day equal should be true. Okay. So what I am saying here is, okay, write it in this one. My day, which is the day of this today, okay, if it is equal to other object day, other dot day, okay, then okay, this boolean will be true, otherwise it will be false, right? Okay, this is the first thing. The other one is month equal. My month, if it is equal to others month, then this will be true. So my result will be, both of them should be true, right? Return day equal, what should I write here? And okay, month equal. That's it. This is my function equals. It might look a little bit complicated, but it is not. It's a regular function. It just happens to have the its parameter type happens to be the same as my class type. But for me, yeah, that's fine for me. Yeah. Yes.
Do we want to move the month from the public, or maybe we still use them outside of here?
But that's a very good question. The question is, we are trying to eliminate access to this day and month from outside. It's our data members. Nobody should be able to access it. So, but we repeated the same mistake. What are we doing? Do you have an answer for this? Are we doing the wrong thing or the right thing? Yes.
maybe we can use different implement a function in function which is a number of this class get date or something like that we can use.
Exactly. The suggestion is let's implement a function which is a member of this class, and that that function can access anything it wants. That's what we did actually. This equals is a member of this function, this class. Equals is a member of this class. Equals is not somebody from outside, okay? It's our member function. Equals is no different. Equals is no different than output. When output accesses our month data members, we are fine, right? So why should we worry about accessing the data members of the object, other object? Okay, there are other objects. They are not my objects. Yeah, as today is equal. Okay, I am working on today's data members, but still, as a function equals, I am still member of this class. So I am not from outside. Okay. I should be able to do anything I want on this class data members or the function members. Okay, as the programmer of this class, as the designer of class, I designed the class interface itself. Okay, I designed the output function, input function, and equals function. Okay, those are all my functions, my programs. If I make a mistake in any of them, it's my fault. Okay, it's not customer's fault. I need to fix them. So equals is under my control, and I should be able to do anything I want with the equals function. Yes.
We didn't make any change on equals function, so why we didn't put constant?
It's a very good suggestion. I didn't want to confuse you about that, but the right thing is send it as a reference. Let me put this in a different color so that. And we should send it as a constant, because day of year is an object, class object, and it has some integers and it's large. I don't want it to be copied many times, so maybe I should send it as a reference, but I am not going to change it, so put a constant on it. Okay, put a constant on it. The other thing is that, okay, what did I do here? I said that This equals function will not change this object, right? That's what I said. But let's look at this one. Read it. Today.equals birthday. This function call will not make any changes to this parameter. How about this parameter? Am I going to change it? No. So how do I say the compiler that I am not going to change it? So the way to this would be very, very early, but the question came and maybe I should point this out. The way to say it is this: you type const here, okay? You say that. Let me put a const here too. You say that the equals, we need a parameter from outside, okay? This equals will not make any changes to that parameter. Also, this equals will not change any, will not make any changes on the object that it works. Okay. Okay. That's the meaning of this const. Okay. That's the meaning of this const. If we implemented this day of year as a struct, okay. If we implemented this as a struct, we had to write, okay, three functions. One is an output, and that output will take how many parameters? No, output. Output will take one parameter, day of year struct, right? Input will take one parameter, but equals will take two parameters, right? Equals will take two parameters. If we implemented this as a struct without any member functions, okay? We will have three global variables, global functions. One is output, one is input, the other one is equals. The output will take the single struct parameters. Input will take the single struct parameter, but equals will take two struct parameters. But it will take them as two constant reference parameters. Okay. So how do I do the same thing in this notation? So I say that I am not going to change my parameter. Also, I promise that I will not change the object that I am working on. Okay? Any other question? Okay, question. When I implement the of your equals, you mean this? This is not bitwise operator, this is logical AND. What do you mean, what does it do? You don't know what logical AND does? Okay, this is very common. This is same as this one. You remember this? Okay, this is very common. You understand, right? Okay, so you already know this from your C classes, right? And it is at the beginning of semester. What did I say? I said that I will not tell you anything very complicated. All the things that I'm going to tell you will be very, very simple. But I will tell you many, many simple things. If you put them together, it will get confusing. And in fact, you will start questioning your previous knowledge, like he's doing now. He's asking me, what is this thing? I never see such a thing. No, you have seen this in the third week of the C course, right? Am I right? I mean, when you do the if statement, you start questioning your previous knowledge, and it's very common. If you don't have these kind of mistakes early in the class, okay, you will never recover. If you try to learn this language starting 1 week from the midterm exam or the final exam, forget about it. No, it will not happen. Okay, if you are not going to, okay, this chapter number 6 and 7 are very important. If you are not going to memorize these two chapters this week, then you are late. I'm sorry, but that's my observation. You cannot learn it later. You should learn it now. Otherwise, these kind of questions are. He's a very good student. He asks very smart questions, but I mean, we are all human beings. We make mistakes, and our brain can absorb only this much stuff in a given time. Although these are not very complicated, but there are many things I am telling you. Okay, maybe the way I tell you is very different, but this is what I observe all the time. If you don't do this on time, if you don't do exercises yourself, okay, I promise you, if you go home just after the class, try to write this day of year yourself, including input, output, and equals. If you are doing this the first time, none of you will get it right. You will get confused. Where are you going to get confused? Some of you will try to do this. Okay, you will say, okay, day of year, then I think I had this, then it should return a boolean, right? It was like that. No, it doesn't look right. What am I doing? Where is this? So many people make this mistake. Many people will think about where is the second parameter coming from, what is other, that kind of stuff. So if you make a few exercises, try to write the same thing yourself, you will be fine, you will be okay. Because as I said, this is not a complicated stuff, this is not complicated, but it takes writing and reading in Turkish is not complicated, right? 8-year-old kids, they do it perfectly, right? That's what we know. But it is not possible to teach someone reading and writing in a week, right? It takes some time. It's very similar to that one. Okay, you need to do lots of practice. Okay, and in this course, I am not expecting you to memorize the syntax and the other kind of written rules in this language. During the exams, I will ask you a problem, a real life problem maybe. Do this in an object oriented language. Okay, that's what I am going to test you on. I am not going to test you on what kind of parameter should be passed to this function or not. So you should achieve all of these. It's like at the end of the semester for a first grade kid, they don't ask him to name the letters or the words, okay? They give him the whole book, read it, okay? And you understand it? If you understand it, answer this question. That's what we are going to do. Okay, that was a very good question, and I am sure many of you have those kind of questions right now. Maybe you are too embarrassed to ask it, but don't do that. Don't be shy about asking those kind of questions, because the person next to you is having the same questions too. Okay, let me have 10 minutes of break. After the break, I will get your shy questions.